I am thrilled to announce content overview for new syllabus of the Evaluating Exam 2025. And this video in the format of PharmaCast, that means a video format of podcast and presented in the discussion format. And this information is based on the PEBC.ca's newly released syllabus for evaluating exam. Here, and you will find those details on the syllabus. And this syllabus is just been released. So now we're discussing information about this syllabus. So let's start.
You're here because you're serious about tackling the PBC evaluating exam. And, well, you want the smart route, right? Not just endless textbook trawling.
Exactly.
Well, welcome. Today, we're really zeroing in on that Refresh 2025 syllabus. We want to pick out those absolutely crucial, high-yield nuggets. You know, the stuff that consistently shows up in top review materials.
Like Dr. Misbah's prep books, for instance. Mm-hmm. They really highlight these key areas.
Precisely. Our goal today is simple. Equip you with the core knowledge so you feel ready, focused, and confident about what truly counts for this exam.
And it's a big step, this exam.
Yeah.
It's that key milestone for internationally trained pharmacists looking to practice here in Canada.
Right.
It's computer-based, remember. 140 multiple-choice questions, over 180 minutes total.
Split into two 90-minute sections, 70 questions each.
Yep. And that magic number is 60% for a pass. So today's deep dive, it's all about structuring your understanding around those three main content pillars and, importantly, their weightings.
Okay, what are they?
Pharmaceutical sciences, that's 25%. Then pharmacy practice, that's the big one at 55%.
55, wow.
And behavioral, social, and administrative sciences rounds it out at 20%. Think of this as our blueprint for studying efficiently.
Okay, sounds like a plan. Let's dive into that first section then. Pharmaceutical sciences, the 25%. First up, pharmaceutics and drug delivery systems. Now, this isn't just about, you know, identifying pills, is it? What are the practical things we need to grab onto?
Well, what's really practical here is understanding the whole journey of a drug product. Mm-hmm. Think about all the different dosage forms, you know, tablets, capsules, sure, but also injectables, inhalers, mm-hmm. more complex stuff, mm-hmm. and the vital role those inactive ingredients, the excipients, play. They really affect performance.
Right. They're not just filler.
Not at all. Compounding is also significant, both non-sterile and sterile preps. So you need to grasp the core principles, the techniques involved.
Okay.
Drug delivery systems, too. Things like extended release or targeted release. And something fundamental, often tested, is drug stability and storage.
Ah, like why some need the fridge or need to be kept out of light.
Exactly. It's not just theoretical. It impacts patient safety every single day, making sure the medicine actually works when it gets to the patient.
Makes sense. Okay, let's tackle the next bit. Pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, PKPD, and biopharmaceutics. Quite a mouthful. What are the absolute must-knows here?
Well, if we tie this back to dosing, it's all about understanding how the patient's body handles the drug. That's the kinetics bit, ADME, absorption, distribution, metabolism, excretion.
What ADME?
And then how the drug affects the body, the dynamics. Hmm. Expect case-based scenarios needing PK calculations, things like half-life. Definitely get comfortable with that.
Okay. Calculations.
And dosage adjustments, especially for patients with kidney or liver problems. That's mm-hmm. crucial.
Mm-hmm.
And a really high yield area, those major drug metabolizing enzymes, specifically the cytochrome P450 system, the CYP enzymes.
Right. Yes. CYP is always popping up.
You really need to know the common substrates the drugs these enzymes act on, but also the inhibitors and inducers.
Inhibitors slow things down, inducers speed them up.
Precisely. Inhibitors act like roadblocks, boosting levels of other drugs, maybe causing toxicity. Inducers do the opposite, potentially making other drugs less effective. Knowing key examples of inhibitors and inducers and the drugs they affect is really important for the exam.
Got it. Those CYP interactions, yeah, they can definitely cause problems.
Uh-huh.
Okay, moving on within pharmaceutical sciences to pharmacology, what's the core knowledge we need locked down here?
This is really about the fundamentals of drug action. Focus on drug classifications, grouping meds by use or mechanism.
Like beta blockers, ACE inhibitors, that kind of thing.
Exactly. And their core mechanisms of action, how they actually work at a molecular level, often interacting with receptors. Critically, you need to identify side effects, adverse effects, allergic reactions, both common and the really severe ones. Patient safety paramount.
Absolutely.
Make sure you know the indications, what the drug is for, and contraindications when you absolutely cannot use it. And a specific tip, something often stressed in review courses. Know those top 200 drugs and their common adverse reactions. It's definitely worth the memory work.
The top 200 list. Okay, good tip. Then there's toxicology. Sounds a bit scary, but what's the practical exam focus?
The practical angle is recognizing and knowing the first steps in managing common overdoses. Especially pay attention to acetaminophen and opioids. These come up a lot.
Acetaminophen and opioids, got it.
You need to spot the key signs and symptoms of an overdose and understand the immediate management principles. That includes knowing which antidote to pick in an acute setting.
Like an acetylcysteine for acetaminophen.
Exactly. And naloxone for opioids. Spot the danger, know the first response.
Okay. Last one in this section. Biotechnology and pharmacogenetics feels very cutting edge. What are the key takeaways for the exam?
What's really relevant here is understanding biologics, these complex drugs, know the basics of how they're made, and the impact of pharmacogenomics, how individual genetic differences affect how patients respond to drugs.
Right. Why the same drug works differently for different people.
Precisely. Be familiar with the classifications of biologics. You know, drugs ending in mAb, often monoclonal antibodies.
Like for autoimmune conditions?
Often, yes. And crucially, because they're usually proteins, understand the special handling and storage they need. They're fragile.
Okay. That wraps up pharmaceutical sciences. Now the big one. Pharmacy practice, 55%. Starting with pathophysiology and clinical biochemistry. How do these connect to patient care on the exam?
This is where basic science directly informs your clinical decisions. You'll need to interpret common lab values. Think kidney function tests like creatinine, liver enzymes, electrolytes.
Like potassium, sodium.
Exactly. And understand what those numbers mean in the context of major diseases. Cardiovascular conditions and infectious diseases are frequently tested, so be ready to link lab results back to the underlying disease process.
So it's not just knowing the normal range, but understanding why it's abnormal in a specific patient.
That's the key, applying the knowledge.
Okay, next, pharmacotherapeutics medication management. This is the heart of that 55%, huge area. Where do we even start focusing?
Yeah, this is arguably the most critical section for actual practice. You need a really solid grasp of therapeutic drug classes across all organ systems and disease states.
Not just memorizing drug names?
No, much more than that. It's about drug therapy problem solving. Can you spot if a drug isn't right or the dose is off? Can you develop a treatment plan for common high-burden conditions?
Like diabetes, hypertension, asthma?
Exactly those. And critically know how to identify potentially life-threatening drug interactions. That means drug-drug, drug-food, drug-natural product, even drug-lab test interactions. This is a core focus in pretty much all review materials for good reason.
Definitely vital for preventing harm. Okay, this section continues with more practical aspects of medication management. What are those key practicalities?
Think about the day-to-day stuff. Understanding medication administration, detailed strengths, dosage forms available, the right routes, typical durations of therapy. And don't forget over-the-counter meds for minor ailments. Know when self-treatment is okay, what works, and importantly, when to tell someone they need to see a doctor.
Referral points. Crucial.
Absolutely. And remember, it's not always just about drugs. Be ready to recommend non-pharmacologic therapies too. Lifestyle changes, diet, exercise, that sort of thing.
Right. The whole picture for the patient. Then we have patient care process and special populations. What are the key considerations here?
This covers the systematic approach. Patient assessment, planning therapy, implementing it, monitoring how it's going, and then evaluating the outcome.
The pharmacist's workflow, basically.
Pretty much. And pay close attention to age-specific stuff. Pediatric dosing is different, often weight-based, needing careful calculation.
Okay.
And then geriatrics, older adults, often on multiple medications, that's polypharmacy. Huge challenges there with interactions, side effects, making sure they actually take their meds properly, adherence.
Adherence is a big one.
Huge. Also, understand concepts like therapeutic substitution swapping for an equivalent drug and strategies to help patients stick to their medication plans.
Makes sense. Following that is calculations. Many find this tricky. What are the absolute must-know calculation types?
Calculations are definitely a big part, yeah. Practice is key. You need to be fluent in reading SIG codes, those prescription abbreviations.
TID, PC, QHS, all that.
All that. Master your basic formulas, ratios, proportions. Be good at calculating concentrations, total quantities, and accurate doses, including weight-based dosing and taper schedules.
Okay.
Allegation comes up, especially for compounding and PEDS doses. Electrolyte calculations, MELs, MEQs, MAM-MOSes, and isotonicity are important too.
Right, for IVs and stuff.
Exactly. And finally, practice calculations for reconstituting parenteral meds and figuring out IV infusion rates. It's broad, so build a solid foundation in each type. They pop up often in review questions.
Sounds like calculator practice is essential. Next up, prescription processing. More than just labeling a bottle, I assume.
Oh, absolutely. It's the whole workflow. Order entry, yes. But also that crucial professional check for appropriateness. Is this the right drug, right dose for this patient, considering everything else? Any interactions?
Yeah.
Contraindications?
Checking everything.
Everything. Know your legal and ethical duties. Familiarity with injection techniques might be needed depending on the setting.
Yeah.
And practical things too, package sizes, unit dose systems, how to use devices like inhalers or insulin pens, parenteral administration considerations.
Those practical details, yeah, that's where mistakes can happen. Super important. Okay, last bit in pharmacy practice, communication and collaborative care. Maybe seen as soft skills, but clearly vital now.
Totally integral. Can you communicate clearly and empathetically with patients? Use motivational interviewing to help them with health behaviors. Mm. That's tested. Mm-hmm. Teamwork is also critical. Understand different healthcare roles, how to communicate effectively with other professionals, how to resolve conflicts if they arise.
Interprofessional collaboration.
Exactly. And be aware of the pharmacist's expanding scope in managing medication therapy as part of that collaborative team.
Okay, we've navigated that massive 55% pharmacy practice section. Phew. Now, behavioral, social, administrative sciences, the final 20%. Let's start with the Canadian healthcare system, health equity, and social determinants of health. Big topic. What are the key connections?
What's crucial here is understanding the big picture, the context you'll be practicing in. Know the different pharmacist roles in different settings, community, hospital, etc.
Okay.
Understand how healthcare is divided, federal versus provincial responsibilities. Health equity is a major focus. Grasp the concept and how social determinants of health impact patients.
Things like income, housing, education.
Exactly. How those affect health outcomes. Specific focus often on Indigenous health, cultural humility, cultural safety, appropriate care, and the need for collaboration.
Recognizing those wider influences on health.
Yes.
Got it. Next, health promotion and disease prevention. What's a pharmacist's proactive role here?
Pharmacists are really key players in proactive health now. Focus on your role in immunizations, effective smoking cessation counseling, and other preventive strategies.
Like screening for chronic diseases.
Spot on. Screening for things like diabetes or hypertension. Think about how you can help keep people well, not just treat sickness.
That preventative side is definitely growing. Then, pharmacy regulations. What regulatory areas do we absolutely need to know?
This is the legal framework. You need a solid handle on federal drug regulations, the Controlled Substances Act, and the Narcotic and Controlled Drugs Regulations. Knowing these is just fundamental to practicing safely and legally.
Non-negotiable, really.
Absolutely.
Following regulations is literature evaluation. Sounds like critical thinking time.
It is. Can you critically appraise research? Judge its strengths, weaknesses, whether it applies to your patient.
Okay.
Understand different study designs. Apply evidence-based decision-making. Know basic concepts in pharmacoepidemiology, drug use in populations, and pharmacoeconomics, cost-effectiveness, insurance model.
And stats.
Basic biostats, yes. Understanding p-values, confidence intervals, assessing study validity, and if the results are actually meaningful clinically.
Being a smart consumer of research, basically.
That's a good way to put it. Translate research into good patient care.
Okay. Next, medication and patient safety practices. Clearly a top priority.
Undeniably. Focus on minimizing risk. Understand high alert medications, drugs with high risk of harm if used wrong. And lastly, drugs look alike, sound alike, common sources of errors.
Oh yeah, those tricky names.
Exactly. Know error prevention strategies. Know when patient counseling is absolutely needed to prevent mistakes. Understand drug utilization reviews, DURs, how they help catch potential problems.
Proactive safety measures. Makes sense. Then professionalism and ethics. The core values.
Yep. Ethical principles, dilemmas you might face, professional standards of conduct, cultural competence, working effectively with diverse patients, maybe even leadership or preceptorship roles down the line.
Acting with integrity, putting the patient first. Finally, in this section, pharmacy management. Seems less clinical, but still part of the picture.
It gives context for how pharmacies operate. Basic financial principles, personnel management, ethical marketing, quality improvement, risk management, workplace safety. You might not manage directly at first, but understanding it helps the whole system work better.
Okay, wow. We've really covered the ground on all three content areas of this updated 2025 PBC evaluating exam syllabus. It's a lot.
It is a significant amount of information, no doubt.
But hopefully this targeted breakdown, especially keeping in mind those high yield areas you see in prep courses and, you know, resources like Dr. Misbah's books, gives everyone a much clearer roadmap.
Absolutely. That was the goal, to give you a strategic overview, pinpoint those core concepts and practical applications that are, well, frequently emphasized. Use this outline as your framework.
Yeah.
Definitely. Dig deeper into each area with your study materials. Focus on the why behind the what, and always think about those practical patient care implications we discussed.
Right. And that brings us to our final thought for you today. Thinking about this whole scope of knowledge, what specific area do you feel presents your biggest opportunity for growth right now? Where do you need to focus? And maybe what's one concrete step you'll take this week to strategically tackle it?
Good question for self-reflection.
Yeah, take some time with that as you study. We really wish you all the very best as you prepare for the PBC evaluating exam.